Let us stand.
I'm the resurrection and the life, said the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. He that liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
church, say amen. We thank God for this day. We thank God for the life journey of Sister Anita Olivia Abrams. And we thank God for those of you who have come to celebrate in the remembrance as we recall and lift up those high points of her living. We're grateful for family that has come and supporters, friends, and community who will share. And we will receive our prayer following our opening hymn, hymn number 450, Blessed Assurance, a prayer to be followed by the Reverend Ernest Farrell. The scriptures to be read by the Reverend David Williams, Reverend Miriam Ellis, and then a selection in that order. Let us join with uplifted voices in singing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
God, we know that all things come from you. you who have made us and not we ourselves. We come before you once again to acknowledge that you are our Lord and our Savior and our Redeemer. We come, Lord, because and the prophet said that you would be a comforter. And we recognize, God, that there are times when we all need to be comforted. And right now we believe is that time. Pray that you will comfort the Abrams family and all those who come to share. That they be reminded that you are all in charge of all of our lives because of you made us in your image. We pray for strength. We pray for the blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Because God, when we are reassured, even in time of death, that there's a place that you have prepared for us who believe one day that you're coming back for church without wrinkle or spot. You're coming back for souls who love you and who have given you their lives and declare that they will serve you until they leave this earth. We pray that you will continue, God, to reassure us, uplift us. We have heavy burdens sometimes, but God, you promise to lift our burdens and to be there where we need you the most. We need you now. We need you now, God, to fill the void that's being left by this wonderful matriarch of yours who you love and have called to be with you. Pray that you will strengthen and reassure everyone that your love is available. Bless now, Lord Jesus. Bless this worship experience today that maybe somebody who don't know you like Sister Abrams did, they may need to come and let you know that you are their Lord and their Savior and they're willing to serve you. We're going to give you all the praise and all the honor that you so rightly deserve. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen and amen. The 121st Psalm. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Let's give God some love. Bring the offering.
quite this somber, because that wasn't Cousin Meat at all. But I was selected to talk about Cousin Meat from family. So I just want to share a few memories from A Tale of Two Sisters. Because, you know, I'm one of the younger, and so it's hearsay. But hearsay within the family is called legacy. The two sisters I want to share a few memories about are Susie and Gussie. Because Susie had wonderful children that she kept in her home and gathered and raised lovingly. And to us, they were cousin brother, cousin T-Bone, cousin Pearl, cousin Audrey, cousin Green, and cousin Meat. But as I stand before you, I stand in the stead of Gussie's beautiful children, who were Annie Mae, Carrie, Eunice, Olive, Thomas Wilson Jr., Aaron, and our beloved James W. Chief Wilson. And I have a special honor because there was just a very special bond between Meat and Chief. I have to tell this a little bit in retrospect with the connotation of my daddy, because my daddy was the baby in his family, and his four sisters spoiled him and just smothered him with attention. And he thought he was going to be Mr. Big Stuff in Sanford, Florida, shining shoes in a Navy town during the Korean War. He had six guys working, and you couldn't tell him he didn't have it together. He wore zoot suits, and he was a jitterbug. But there was a rival here in Tallahassee of a man named William E. Foster, who was going to start a new wave in marching bands. He heard about the bass horn player at Crooms Academy in Sanford and thought he might be a wonderful student to start the Marching 100 with. So he sent him a scholarship, but that was for tuition and books. Where would he sleep and where would he eat? It was war, after all. And so those were Daddy's excuses for not coming. But thank God for my aunties, because they put him on a train from Gussie's house to Susie's house. And he found home, even though he missed Annie, Olive, Carrie, and Eunice. He found home in Pearl, Meek, Audrey, and Green. And that bond never left. He graduated fancy, went back and founded the Jones High School Band, which is legend. But there was just something about the hill in Aunt Susie's house. He never missed a home game for decades. I remember one notorious game where I was, when you're a baby, they just throw you in the back seat, shut up, can't say anything. And it rained the entire game. But they decided the 100-foot march. And so my sister, being the oldest, she and Daddy got to get out and go and see the 100 march, and I had to sit in the car with Mom. But it didn't matter, because after the game, we were gonna go over here on Pacey Road and stay at Aunt Susie's house. Because there was always a warm meal, a warm, soft bed, and home, and family. I remember I was an undergraduate at FAMU by then, and my aunt, who ran a funeral home in Sanford, Wilson Eichelberger, drove up in a limo across the old set, if you know, you know, up on McGuinn, and picked me up in the limo to come and say goodbye to Aunt Susie. And I was sad about that. But I needn't have been, because Neaton stepped right in, and nothing changed for years. I really didn't understand how he could be as close to Cousin Meat as he was. And I mean, he loved all his cousins, but really loved me. I didn't know about colors and letters yet, you know. But there was a woman of Zeta Phi Beta in his family, who I'm sure had a lot of influence over my father becoming a man of Phi Beta Sigma fraternity. And even though my sister Jamia and my cousin Lenedra went to the University of Florida and decided to wear different colors, I decided that I would again be in the back seat. And as Mom and I drove up from Orlando, pulled out all these wonderful sweet confections, cakes and pies that pledgees aren't allowed to eat. And they tried on the clothes, and Cousin Marie would fuss and Cousin Pearl would fuss over the clothes, and my mom grew up very poor, so she was fussing over Jamie's clothes. But me and Cousin Me were having cake, and we were laughing. I cherished those days. That was a time when you could get on the Greyhound bus as 14 and drive right up from Orlando to Gainesville and sleep on the floor in a sleeping bag and watch Lynette be a cheerleader and my sister on the field with the band. As my parents have aged and grown older, the Florida Classic became the preeminent game. And even as loved ones made their transition, need always came. And I don't know if they've ever shown a commercial here, but there's a commercial I know where older people step into an old house, and as they walk through the door, they become children again. And that's how it was when Neat came to our house. When she walked through that door, she and Daddy became thick as thieves. And they would laugh, and they would sniggle, and they would get tickled. And you know, he was the great and lauded chief in Orlando, but he was butler to all of Susie's kids. And you really have to be their age to know the whole butler and everything. But this is a digital time, and families don't know each other the way they used to. We don't gather for reunions. We barely get together for funerals and weddings. And we have really lost something in this society because we don't keep those bonds. With Anita's transition, Susie's kids are complete in eternity, and Gussie's babies will greet her warmly the way they did when they were here. And, you know, Jam, Ed, and I, we can talk about sorority things, and it's good to see Ronnie and Fadrita and Lana. But the numbers are getting very thin. Thank God for the memories that Anita made sure continued into my father's 90s and her own. I stand before you, a proud daughter of him, and my mother, who is 95 and a half, and cannot make this trip any longer, but she considered me her sister and her friend. In fact, when Jan was moving back to Florida, Neat came to babysit my mom while I went back to help Jim move. That was quite something. Love your family, love your loved ones, and revere elders like Anita, because she poured into her students, but she also gave this family a legacy that I pray we are able to continue, because as I remember her, she's the sweet cousin who made my daddy smile, who I would eat sweets with. And she and Aunt Susie would talk about my grandmother and my aunts and uncles with the fondness of preteens. And that is what her legacy is. Thank you, and God bless you.
it was just the way that she just expressed it. Even when I saw her at the birthday party, you know, that name, Malik, it's like that's how she called me. But it was such a, you know, I felt the love when she said it. And it always meant a lot to me. But the love that she and all of me had never was questioned. And
Reverend Proctor, Reverend Bethel, Reverend Glenn, Reverend Williams, this beloved family, members of Bethel, friends, and the many classes of Lincoln High School, good morning. Resolutions for the late sister Anita Olivia Abrams, a beautiful chapter in the life book of Sister Anita Olivia Abrams is closed. However, pages are filled with love, laughter, friendship, and kind deeds are forever shining in the memories of those who knew her and loved her. Whereas it has pleased our Heavenly Father to translate from the labor of this life to the sweet rest and fellowship of the saints in heaven, our dearly beloved sister in the Lord, Sister Anita Olivia Abrams, the aunt of Sister Lenedra Carroll and Frederita Gallimore, both members of Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church. And whereas Sister Abrams, a phenomenal woman, exemplary Christian, extraordinary educator, lived a life of service and care. She found solace in helping wherever she could. She taught in Leon County schools for over 40 years at the original Lincoln High School and the Augusta Wall Middle School. She was reverenced by her former students, co-workers, administrators, and all who knew her, held her in high esteem. Whereas Sister Abrams learned to walk with the Lord at an early age and never strayed. She was baptized during childhood at Mount Valley Primitive Baptist Church, where her father was the founding pastor. Thus, the characteristics of a woman of strength and exceptional intellect unfold and impact the lives of others for many generations. A longtime teacher to many, she was a quiet, sweet-mannered individual. Her primary ministry at Bethel was singing her praises to the Lord in the senior choir. However, she was a diligent worker and supported the programs throughout the church. She was to acknowledge resolutions as follows. Bethel Stewardess Board Number 1, where Sister Lenander is a member, and Sister Hildred Jackson is the president. Lincoln High School Class of 62, Eddie Graham, president. Lincoln High Class of 59, John Franklin, president. Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, Incorporated. Brothers and sisters, this family wants you to know, during this new season of their lives, they thank God for each one of you and your expressions of love, kindness, and care. Every call, every prayer, every uplifting word of comfort has been such a blessing to the family. Thank you for sharing in this celebration of life, of the life of Sister Anita Abrams, showers of blessing and gratitude. I'd like to say to the family that I too am grateful for having had the benefit of being taught and nurtured by Mrs. Abrams. And of course, she reminds me of it on Sunday morning. Not only the nurturing, but as Kevin Glenn said, she, those teachers, made sure that we understood that not only could we learn, but we were going to learn. So we were grateful. So let us all just give another round of applause for the life. Know that your Bethel family is just a phone call. God bless you.
This is for our family, and it's not just saying goodbye to Tani. Tani was the oldest of four sisters that were the mothers to us all. And so she took care of all of us, and she took care of all of them. And she said goodbye to all of them with us. And she held on. And she held on until not only did she take care of me and make a man out of me, but she got to see my daughter born as well. Tani was tough, okay? Tani was strong. One of our top memories, the memories I think about is the first time I ever saw a snake outside was that Tani handled a snake outside. if there was a palmetto bug to dare step in our house, that Tani was on the hunt. That Tani took care of those things until I was old enough to be the man of the house. And she was tough on me. I didn't understand at the time. I didn't understand why she was so heart about the little things, and she didn't let go of little things. And she wanted to know what I was doing and make sure she knew how I was doing it. And now, as a man with a daughter, I understand just how important the little things are. And I understand exactly why she was how she was. And I'm so grateful for it. So, again, y'all need to understand we all call it auntie, but this is mom. This is the matriarch of my family, the one that held it together and that took care of everyone you see in these pews. And it's hard for us all to say goodbye. It's hard for us all to say goodbye to all of the women that she represents the generation of, all my mothers. And when I stepped through these doors, if someone were to ask me about my mom, I would get confused, honestly. Because, yeah, I have one mom that I can call mom, but which one are you talking about? Are you talking about the one that fed me every day? That's a Tanine. Are you talking about the one that kept me clean every day? That's a Tareen. Are you talking about the one that taught me how to handle my emotions? Are you talking about the one that taught me how to play, who made a place for me to have fun? That's an Audrey. Are you talking about the one that made sure I was a scholar? That's a Tupuro. We had a lot of moms. And today we're saying goodbye to all of them, not just a Tanine.
Church, say amen.
Amen.
Well, thank you, Brother Yari, for those warm encouraging words. Let's give Yari a hand. coming in our procession, Pharaoh said, "This is our last teacher from Lincoln. This is our last teacher." And it's as though a legacy or a chapter, as a representative on payroll from the Lincoln High School, this is it. But the legacy, as we've heard, the witnesses, the voices, continues through the lives and the work that we do. Choir, y'all, just something else, choir. Let's give the choir one. I want to do that because here, I need to tell y'all that all the teachers, I never did like English teachers. I never liked no teacher tell me what to say and how to write it. And Miss Kusta, I got a D in college from an English teacher. Out of all the other teachers, I remember that lady giving me a D. But my mama was a librarian. I read everything. I had a whole library, family high school was mine. And I figured that I had read and claimed enough words that I ain't need an English teacher telling me how to talk, what to write. And out of all the teachers on the faculty, figured that that was just somebody they really excess, they didn't really need that. And at least I didn't believe I needed it. But I'm so grateful for the testimony that has been wrought because we all need an English teacher. And coming from many people pouring into the old Lincoln, came from communities, settlements, from rural places, and they were coming into town, if you will. And the need to restructure the semantics of many people evolving from the rural backgrounds. Lincoln needed all of those teachers that you outlined, Dr. Glenn, to make sure that for those students who would be competitive and pursuing higher pursuits in academia, that they indeed would be able to pass the English bar of the standardized test. Today, we have words which challenge us. Yeah, those words are also comforting to us because those words equalize the playing field. And those words were found at Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 11. Still in those letters one. Again, I saw that under the sun, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to the intelligent, nor favor to the skillful. But time and chance happen to them all. I like to take as a thought, as a message topic, prior to, P-R-I-O-R. Prior to. I know that this topic is totally, an English teacher would not approve it, Dr. Williams, but I never give an English teacher nothing that I had to say. But that's why it's all jacked up in the way it is with me, because it's been to English. Prior to. Sister Abrams is largely a sister who captures that meaning of being a prior to one. It's amazing that, and it's born a reality, that the firstborn is the last to say goodbye among her siblings. And it's been said that the last verse to the 1965 Voter Rights Act, prior to Selma to Montgomery March, Bloody Sunday, prior to AI, cell phones, CDs, TVs, prior to interracial marriages of loving versus loving, prior to Apollo 11 landing on the moon, prior to I Have a Dream speech by Dr. Martin Luther King, prior to refrigerators that make ice cubes, prior to Jackie Robinson joining Major League Baseball, prior to Fam C becoming Fam U, prior to Dr. King's letter from a Birmingham jail and his book titled Why We Can't Wait, Sister Abrams, prior to all of these occurrences, was shaped in a nest of love. The Abrams family was special. Like the music group Sister Sledge sang, but prior to their ever being born, the daughters of the Reverend T.J. Abrams and Mother Susie Abrams were already endowed with the thought, we are family. I got all my sisters in me, kindled by the tender flames of love, like little birds in the nest. The daughters of the Reverend and Mother Abrams were pampered in love inside of their home and family. Wonderful daughters cultivated by a school teacher mother and one of the leading pastors of the city, the Abrams sisters before or prior to Sister Sledge, prior to the Hutchison girls of emotions, or prior to the Jones girls, they were already the cat's meow, pretty, sweet, classy, lovely, swag. It ain't bragging when it's true. When sisters had it going on, as the Abrams daughters did, a woman of necessity has to be a bit defensive. Of necessity, she has to be somewhat, just a little withdrawn. Of necessity, she's gonna handle herself a little more carefully. Of necessity, she learns to see others coming before they see her. You know, when you are pretty and you're sweet and you're classy and you're lady and you're lovely and you're swag, of necessity, one draws tighter to a family circle when one holds the distinction of being pretty, sweet, classy, lovely, swag. Poor Reverend T.J. Abrams, I know he was a nonviolent man overall, but of necessity, he kept a loaded shotgun just in case, because he knew how extraordinary his nest of little birds were. Can y'all imagine, just for a moment, these pretty, sweet, smart young girls, all vying for daddy's attention and wanting to be daddy's favorite daughter. Daddy, our mentor, is being mean to me, Daddy. Daddy, I want some ice cream. Daddy, you like the picture, Daddy, that I drew? Daddy, pick me up, Daddy. Pick me up. Don't pick her up. Pick me up, Daddy. Daddy, we are not playing fair. Daddy, you got some candy? Oh, God, what you got, Daddy? Just for another moment, imagine. So, imagine last night, I called a young lady named Haley Brocker. I said, Haley, I sent you a notice stating the schools will be closed in Orlando tomorrow. I leave through Wednesday. She said, I heard something like that. today we can come home, but we, the full 4 million people, pack up Interstate 75, and you can get up there before next week. Haley said, Dad, I have a 9 o'clock Zoom meeting, and I will evaluate what I will do afterwards.
Now, y'all,
y'all, Reverend Mary, I didn't say those words. This is an English teacher that we're standing before today. But there are some words. When I heard Marla talking, I said, I didn't know if I'm going to give my Christian message or my other message. And Marla broke it down. She said, Dad, I will evaluate what I will do afterwards. All I'm trying to say, y'all, is poor Reverend Abrams, with all of his grown-up and wannabe independent grown daughters telling him, Dad, I got this. On top of it all, Mother Susie Abrams maintained, I'm sure, a healthy honey-do list for Pastor Abrams. As I think about the Abrams family, it is Daddy Abrams who endured magnificently with all his Haleys and their mother. Somebody ought to say amen. I'm impressed today that the ecclesial writer noted in chapter 9, verse 11, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth to them all. The time, 1925, and I love the way it's captured in program today. I love that 1925, the years of jazz musicians Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington recording their first songs, 1925. Time and chance happened to them all. And the time is 1925 when it happened. The dash until 2024, the spans, 98 years, the percent of Americans who attain 98 years, time and chance happened to them all. But 98 years worth of time never happened to them all. 98 years happens to less than 1% of the people who live in America. So I, you know me, I Google it. How many people live to be 98? You know, his dad just asked, who? Google said, we don't have 98, but we can tell you that 0.03% reach 100. It's under 1%. But time and chance happened to them all. But ain't everybody gonna get 98 years. That's why we can pause here and say that God has been good and was good to the Abrams for the time he gave her that only less than 1% of the people who live ever receive in something called a lifetime. She's got way more time. I don't know if the English teacher would approve that, Brother Farrell. But she's got way more time than 99%. Of American population. Moreover, a teacher as a profession, chance, time, and chance happening to them all. Chance. How many black girls born in 1925 got a chance to go to college? How many black girls born in the 1920s went on to become educated? And to become a school educator exceeding 4 decades. But chance happeneth for Anita Abrams. The chance to be born to an outstanding parents, to grow within an outstanding family, a chance to live in an outstanding community called Tallahassee, the chance to worship in an outstanding church called Bethel. A chance to love on outstanding nieces and nephews and friends of the family. And speaking of nephews, I told Marlon, I mean, jumper in the corner to rival that major shot that he put up. But I didn't tell Gallimore that I was trying to do nothing to look like him and Simone Biles in that gymnastics stuff. Gallimore, you got that covered, man. I ain't gonna touch it. But when we were Pee Wee teammates, y'all need to know that we had a clinic after every practice. Gallimore would do the most amazing thing off of his feet and spin. When they said that Michael Jordan and Julius Erving was all of that and all of that, I didn't think nothing about it because Gallimore had took the basketball down the court and did a somersault flip and dunked the ball. And I have not seen that in the dunk contest yet in the NBA. Gallimore went down the long jump and hit the board and flipped out of the jump. And I haven't seen that in the Olympics. So I failed to be impressed in part because of the high level of sports and athleticism that Gallimore was brought in this community. The thing about life, parents can plan as best they can, but God anoints his favor on a child's life. And nobody can attain success and sustain success without the endorsement of God Almighty. Anita's life enjoyed the endorsement of God. She, no doubt, had heard Billie Holiday say, your mama may have, and your papa may have, but God bless the child who has their own. And though her daddy was a preacher and the pastor of the Philadelphia Primitive Baptist Church where I grew up, yet she did not bank on her daddy's title as the preacher and pastor. But prior to leaving here, she established a relationship with God that was all her own. And I'm glad today to bear witness that I personally have seen Sister Anita Abrams in the Bethel AME Church again and again, and over and over. And before or prior to seeing her as a member of this church, I saw Sister Abrams with my own eyes again and again, over and over, attending the services in the Philadelphia Primitive Baptist Church. And I am persuaded that she, like her mother and father, and I am persuaded that she, like all of her siblings, I am persuaded that by her steadfast presence in the house of the Lord, that she was hooked up with the Lord, that she was tied up and tangled up with the Lord, that she was anchored and her soul was anchored in the Lord. For this kind, she has received on this earth for the chance she received to be a professional woman for 40 years, I dare say it was her faith in God that kept her balanced, kept her whole, kept her sane, and kept her for 98 years going through life's ups and downs, going through Jim Crow, going through the civil rights era, going through pain and heartache, sunshine and rain that 98 years will present to anyone. But I'm glad to note in our program today that prior to her leaving, she found former President Jimmy Carter's upcoming 100th birthday a remarkable thing. And I'm glad today that prior to her goodbyes, she was excited and ready to cast her next presidential vote on November the 5th. And prior to checking out, I'm glad
into a classroom. Because a teacher recognizes that words are interpreted multiple ways by different minds. And a teacher prays to Almighty God that these students will understand and that God will guide her words as she's planting seed. And a teacher watches her pupils with hopes and with prayers that they will rise up and reach their maximum potential. Prior to, I'm glad that she saw the Reverend Ernest Fair, our next door neighbor, man and lead the urban league for years. I'm glad that she saw the Al Lawson stand up to be a senator and a congressman representing our community. Prior to leaving, she got a chance to learn that the pastor of this church, Bishop McAllister, made it on the first ballot. And prior to leaving, she saw, and I'm glad that she saw, Barack Obama become the president. But I could be happy about all of that, but I want to make sure that you are clear that prior to her leaving here, she saw little old nappy-headed Bill Proctor become a commissioner in this community. And I'm glad that prior to her leaving, she saw God work with me and lift me and stand by me all these years. And I believe that beyond a doubt that Paul's declaration to Timothy, she was able to say to her family, I'm 98. But prior to leaving, she's able to say, y'all, I fought a good fight. I finished the course. I have kept the faith. And henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And to all that love his appearance, praise be to God for the life and journey of Anita Abrams. Prior to her hearing God sing, soldier, well done, enter into the joy of the Lord. Thank you.
a few